Okay, Mr. Hart, can you give us your full name and your date of birth, please?
Bill Hart, full name William Homer Hart Jr., born May 7th, 1918.
Okay, can you tell us how you came to come to Sylvan Beach?
As the story goes in the family, my grandparents were here. They stayed in what became the McDowell Cottage, which took roomers at that time. And subsequently, my mother and father came, and my first summer here was the summer I was born, 1918.
Now, do you remember what summer your parents may have come, the first summer that they were here, what year that would have been?
I don't remember. I think, though, it was about the 1900. I do know my mother and her sister Alice were in the Jinx, and I think that was 1912, but I'm not sure. We have a picture of it. The girls, instead of the kick line in those days, you couldn't kick very much with the long skirts. They had some costume called the Yama Yama girls, big hats and lots of stuff.
Okay.
And Alice and Bertha were both in that Jinx.
I see. So it was kind of a dress a lot back then, but still we're doing a dance of sorts. Speaking of jinxes, can you remember your first jinx that you were in?
Not the first one. They didn't have the really young people in. The jinx acts were scripted, and you had to learn lines and so forth. So they were old. It started older, but I was in the late 20s certainly. Then Frank Adams was directing the one I remember first, and we had to try out for the parts. I did not do very well in the tryout. I always thought I was sort of a ham, but it didn't show. So I was assistant stage manager for my first really official jinx, and did the curtain, which was the big thing. We had nothing automatic. You ran out and pulled that thing across.
Oh, you ran out on the stage,
yeah.
Wow, okay. Frank Adams, you know, you mentioned a character from the past. Can you tell me something about him or your memories about him?
Oh, the perfectly marvelous man. He had the kids so enthusiastic you couldn't believe. And of course, he was a famous playwright long before he went to Hollywood. And the story that I remember, and I remember an awful lot of things that aren't true right now, but I've told it enough so that it's now become part of my memory. But the one year while we were here, he had two plays on Broadway at the same time. One of them, his partner was Will Huff. And from one of those plays, the song that Frank and Will wrote, I Wonder Who's Kissing Her Now.
Okay.
So he was, of course, very well known. To my parents particularly. He wrote some novels and then wrote scripts for Hollywood after they moved to California.
I see. I do remember that song, even I remember that song myself. With the jinxes, do you remember any jinxes in particular that you thought were really fantastic?
Mostly I remember acts.
Great.
Particular one I really thought was wonderful. Emily Casperi sat all alone in a spotlight and sang All Alone at the Telephone, which was a late 20s song. And then later on in that same act, I think Phil Vandeventer came in. I don't remember much more about that one. Then many years later, they had that wonderful series of shows, in each of which somebody carried a potted plant across the stage and said, flowers for Mrs. Hodgson. And each year it got to be bigger, and finally somebody staggered across with a half of a maple tree, I think, still with the same gag line, and it had great continuity.
Yes, even when I was in the Jinx growing up, that was still a line that we used. It was a
wonderful line.
Mrs. Hodgson, yes. Do you have any more memories of great lines or any accidents that happened at the show or mistakes?
Well, I got to feel that they were most of the shows were sort of an accident. One of the acts that I remember, we all, what the heck was the name of the song? The girls, there were six of us, three boys and three girls. The girls sat on our knee. We were stooped down, and Bill Getz and I and one other, maybe Eddie Middleton, wore brown derbies, so it must have been around the year of Al Smith or something, and cigars. And I can't think for the minute what the song was, but when I see Jeannie Schmidt to this day, why, she was the one on my lap, and we still will sing that.
I'll be there.
Neither of us had a voice, but it was volume, which was important, because there was no microphone in those days, and we were very big on volume.
It wasn't quite a matter of quality, but just getting it out there loud enough.
They could hear in the back of the house.
Yeah, I think that's the most important thing with the Jinx myself, many times.
Now I have the song, Tell Me Pretty Maiden.
Do you remember how that goes at all?
Oh, I can do the way I always sang it.
Yeah.
Now tell me, pretty maiden, what these very simple girlies do. Their manners are perfection, and the opposite of yours. They would face us, of course, for that. It went on.
Okay.
But that's the general idea of it.
And you said Al Smith, so that must have been about 1928 or 32?
I think this was probably 32.
Al Smith. As you went on in the years, then in the 30s, do you remember any more Jinxes?
No, I remember a much later one.
And how long did Frank Adams go into this period with you?
You'd have to check Larna on that one. She was always a very big part of it. Larna was organized, is organized to this day, and I'm sure that that kept Frank going because he took on so many things all the time, and she kept him so he could do these things. Because he was a busy man when he put this stuff on.
Well, you're saying, if he had two Broadway shows.
Yeah.
That's awfully busy. Okay. So you basically did the Jinxes up and through the 30s during your childhood up until the time you probably went to.
Yeah, then later on when we just were here, when I was grown, we were only here on weekends. We always would have to be here in time early enough Friday to get in the Jinx. In those days, we didn't have any rehearsal. We just got here and they'd give you the songs. And for the most part, you knew what the songs were, but you had to try to fake in the words they'd written.
You didn't rehearse, you see?
No, we just showed up Friday. We had to get off work early and get here by time for the show, and then Saturday was always a little better because we had an idea where we were supposed to be.
Yeah.
But those were just singing things. We had no lines particularly to deliver, so that if we could get the idea of the song, it was fine.
Great. Okay. You mentioned coming up here on the weekends, and that, of course, when you were younger, you were here the whole time, and you drove up from Chicago?
We came on the Goodrich, the Carolina.
Okay.
We would come in, when we were here all the time, the fathers would come in. As I recall it, the Chicago gang used to get together for dinner, usually at the Chicago Athletic Club or the Chicago Club, and then go down to Navy Pier and board the Carolina, which left at midnight. And they'd play Hearts until time to leave, and then they'd go to bed and wake up in White Lake. And the oldest child in our family, and in most of them, was supposed to meet the boat and take Dad's bag because he had dressed for golf, and the men went straight to the golf club. And Sunday night was even more exciting because the Kearns had the stuff at the dock, including ice cream and popcorn, and you'd go down and you'd all get to have popcorn and see the parents, your father, off. Then you'd run across the hill there when the boat came out into the lake. And the Sylvan Beach dads all had portside, they're all outside cabins, they had portside cabins. And outside of each cabin was a light, and they wore those straw skimmers in those days. And Dad would hold his hat over the light and do the family code. And we'd say, "That's my dad." Oh, it was a very exciting time.
Oh, I imagine it was. What time on Sunday did they leave for Chicago?
Right after supper.
Right after supper. Then, so they'd get in about midnight?
No, they used to stop at Grand Haven. So they got into Chicago around 7 in the morning.
And then they went right to work,
yeah,
getting off the boat.
Sure.
So, and they generally each had their own cabin?
Yes, they were quite small, but all outside.
Okay. Do you remember your father ever talking about, do you ever remember any particular trip on the Carolina that was exciting or storm or any?
I just don't.
Breakdowns?
As far as I thought, it just ran on a regular schedule and never had any problem. It was so easy. It was a great way to come. Later years, we came by train on the Pier Marquette into Muskegon. And in fact, before that even, the Carolina stopped coming in here, and they used the city of Grand Rapids and the Alabama, which went into Muskegon. So we would have to be picked up in Muskegon and taken back there. Yeah, that's I don't know, I think they're just 2 or 3 years, and then Goodrich went out of business.
Okay, approximately what year was that they went out of business? Just approximately.
Oh, golly. Time has condensed a little for me. They all seem to have mushed in together. It must have been in the 30s, no later than that.
Would you have it? Do you know why they went out of business for
a minute? You couldn't make money in that short a season. I'm sure that was it. Their costs, the labor costs, of course, were enormous compared to what they had been in the beginning, and there was just no way to do it. This new fellow that's running boats now is the first one I've ever heard of that could make a go of it, and he's doing just fine because now people are excited about it again, and they take cars, and of course, the Alabama and the city of Grand Rapids took cars also.
Now, who owned them, those two boats?
They were part of Goodrich.
Goodrich, too. Also.
Uh-huh.
Okay. How many ships did they have in that line? Do you have any?
No, I would guess there were probably 3 or 4 others, including that whaleback, the Christopher Columbus, that Chicagoans would remember because it was in the Chicago River. It looked like a submarine, really. And it didn't turn over, which always surprised me. We counted on that. It looked just, you know, like a submarine, but it was came up out of the water more than that.
And never, it just rode the waves well? Just,
yeah, it sort of went through them.
I'll be darned. Did that have cabins on it?
Oh, sure. It just, the shape was, there wasn't a flat deck, it curved around, although there was room to walk, but it looked, it didn't look like a regular ship.
Okay. What, when you were a child here, let's say when you were 14, 15, who were your peers and what did you do during the summer?
Well, we had a fairly tight gang. The song we sing every summer, the Sylvan Beach Gang, it was a very tight, nobody else ever was in it. And people that came up for the first time, it was, I'm sure, awkward because as children, you just weren't as nice about things.
Yeah.
Not knowingly, you just weren't. But, of course, the Middleton family, Eddie and Billy McDonald and Lucy Lee and Dorothy, and then the Works were part of that same family. They're Peg Dilley now, of course, and her brothers and sister were here at the same time. Then the Murdochs, Jeannie and Fiffy, and little older, and the gorgeous group included Joe Hanchett, now Joe Hartman, Barb Spear and her sister Betty, and one of the Berkey Jones daughters. They were just a little older, And the fellas that went with that gang were the Runyon Boys, Bud and Joe, and all the and the fellas that were that group were all fine athletes. Bob McDowell and Sonny Seckel, and they used to have big tennis games down there with good players. George Lott, who was a great buddy of Bob McDowell's, was a Davis Cup player, and so that it was good tennis. John Nevin played, also a very serious tennis player, and Art Rooney, who played on the Northwestern tennis team. And Art had a very good buddy who was captain of the tennis team and also a marvelous football player whose name I think was Bergherm, but I'm not sure about that. And he was always there. Then other athletic activities of the Sunday afternoon baseball game. And we had some good baseball players. Big Bill Vann and Phil Vann both had played college baseball and were good. So we found after the first year we had to get a 16-inch softball. And you don't see many. It's like hitting your pillow. But it's the only way you could keep it in the park with those people. Bill Vann could hit the ball clear across the road from the, where our backstop is, so with a 10-inch ball. But with a 16-inch ball, you could catch it all right. He could just get it to the road. And they were marvelous. The Flitcrafts played in that. You don't see any of them now, but that was quite a big family. Everything north of Division Place was Flitcraft property.
The mentioning that name and the, of course, Phil Vandeventer your age?
No, Phil was probably 4 or 5 years older.
Okay, and I guess they. Do you remember any of those tennis games they had? I've heard.
Oh, sure, lots of them. They were good tennis.
Real good till you were talking.
Yeah, the
about
two Vandeventers usually teamed up. Bob McDowell played with either Art Rooney or with John Nevin. And when George Lott was here, why the two of them, in fact, I believe that George Lott and Bob McDowell were trying out for the Davis Cup doubles team when Bob had a serious accident and he never quite could play as well.
What type of accident?
He was hit by a, he was hit by a car while he was changing a tire, but something like that. It was in his head that he got hurt. He had a plate in his head all the rest of his life. In those days, they weren't quite as good at that, no.
Just put something in there, you know. I understand from what I've been told. I guess there used to be quite a good crowd down there when it comes to watching and cheering, even.
Big audience, and there was always a crowd there because that's what there was down there. The post office was there, and the little soda fountain had a porch out over White Lake. The men played cards there all the time. The store was there. And my mother tells me before the store why the little steam launches came and they had to go to Whitehall on the launch to get the groceries. And then Edna Bloomdahl's father and mother started Kearns, and that was the place you went. And when that was gone, well, we still went to Kearns, only we went to Whitehall to go there.
Okay, so you would take a launch there and then to town.
Yeah.
Was that because the people would come up on the boat and there just were no cars or the road to town?
Well, a lot of people didn't have cars and there wasn't a road in the beginning.
There wasn't a road. No. How far did the road go?
The road must have gone to just where Murray Road starts at the golf club. Okay. I mean, from there on into town.
Okay. So there wasn't...
There was a path, as I recall, but it wasn't even gravel, they tell me. I don't remember that, really. We went to the yacht club, of course, but always by boat, by canoe, usually.
Okay. When you were with your peers in that, when you were, let's say, 15, 16, 17, 12, all those years, when you woke up, what would you do? Would you get with the guys and did you have your own boats?
Well, everybody had a canoe, and when you got old enough, some people had sea boats, but this was before Y Flyers, There was some little boat that they would have every now and then. They'd try to get people interested. I don't remember the name of it. A family named Renshaw had the first one. They lived where Peggy Van lives now, which was Frank Adams' house originally. And they were here for quite a few years. At that time, Clarence Pitkin, your grandfather, had slot machines at the dock. And Will Renshaw would sit there and play as long as they'd keep the doors open. He was fascinated with it. He had a chauffeur, oh golly, what was his name? I've forgotten for the minute. A colored fellow who was an absolute hysterically funny man. He played baseball with us. He was a good baseball player. He always played in the Sunday games. And when Will Renshaw had to go to lunch, he'd call and get his chauffeur to come down and keep the machine hot for him so that somebody else couldn't come in and get the jackpot. Oh. The guy would sit there and play during the lunch hour for him.
Oh, that is wild.
He was a funny man, and he was a good fisherman. He'd show any of the youngsters how to fish if they wanted.
So it was just basically, you really never even thought about going to town?
No.
Who would want to with the canoes?
There was no reason until we were old enough to drive. Then we had to go to the sunken garden. That was, you just had to. But I think in the preteens, when you'd finished breakfast, you started out the house door, and as the door slammed, your mother would say, "Where are you going?" "I'm going to the dock." That's all you had to say.
It was, and then everybody would meet down there.
Yeah.
And work from there.
Whatever was going on happened down there.
Do you remember, of course, this was, you were very, very young, but you might remember we're told some stories about, do you remember anything about prohibition here?
No, I just don't. I don't remember that anything was ever particularly dry, but you didn't think about that at that time.
Right. As children, just sort of, when you were teenagers or things like that, did you even think about drinking?
Oh, beer, of course.
Oh, really?
And when I was through high school, I was very, I guess, let me think, when it was Roosevelt first got put in, you had beer.
Yeah, 33.
Yeah. Yeah. So
we all did get your beer.
Sure.
And beer and that type of thing. Did your parents know, or was it just like it is now?
It was never any time that they didn't know. You never think of doing it on the sly. They'd never said you shouldn't ever touch this stuff. And as long as we were careful, I guess we did never make any mess of things. I don't recall that we ever had anything to drink when we were finally driving automobiles. And so I just, I'm sure much later on, but in the beginning that certainly was the case.
When you were driving your cars, about what period of time did you start driving? Did they get the road through? How old were you at the time? 12,
let's see, I was 14, so that would be 1932.
Okay.
Before that, Bill Getz had a Nash convertible, Phaeton, which big green car. He used to drive over here. It was the only one from outside of Sylvan Beach that you ever saw. And he came and would usually bring one of his young sisters with him.
Uh-huh. Always very popular, though.
Oh, everybody got to ride in the open car. That was marvelous.
What type of car was it?
Nash.
Oh, excuse me, you said Nash. Excuse me, yes. Nash, that's fascinating. That's fascinating. Do you remember any car wrecks or anything like that, any problems?
Yeah. Well, there were two I remember, both in our family. One, I was driving family car into Muskegon to the movies at the Michigan Theater, which is where the Frauenthal is now. And in the car, we had Jeannie Schmidt, Ed Middleton, Mac Butterfield, Fiffy, I don't remember. But in those days, we had to go across Giles Road. There wasn't any expressway or anything like that. And they had just oiled a section of the road, not more than 100 yards of it, which I had known, but that's how they repaired it. It was packed gravel, and they had oiled it. Well, you couldn't see that. It was dusk, and there had been a light drizzle earlier, but it was off the road except in that oiled section, and we were just driving straight across the road, and it was humpbacked so that the rear wheel started to slide a little, and when they hit the loose gravel on the edge, it stopped and started the car spinning. It spun around a couple of times and then turned over, landed on its wheels, went all the way over. And that was the only accident I recall ever being in, but it was the biggest thing that we had at that time.
Incredible.
Yeah.
Was it a convertible?
No. No, it hit on the top and then came on over. Nobody got hurt that way, but we didn't have seat belts, and several people were thrown out. I was on the back of the wheel, so I wasn't hurt at all. And I do remember getting out and running towards what was a little gas station and convenience food place somewhere along that road. I think it's still there.
A little brick thing?
Yeah.
And
calling the police, and the only one that was hurt was Jeannie Schmidt, who had a broken back, I think. But she is fine, always has been, played fine golf and everything ever since.
Didn't seem to hurt at all. So she was the one that was really hurt seriously. What did your parents say?
There's not much they could say that would be just terrible. They were concerned about the other children. And that was it. And it wasn't anything I'd done foolishly. We weren't going that fast. However, it was enough of a lesson for care. I'm sure I wasn't as careful as I could have been.
You were about 14 then?
15 maybe.
Yeah, 15, 16. So that must have been quite a journey, actually, for you all to get in a car and go to Mesquite.
Yeah, we did that maybe once every couple of weeks. That's about all they changed the film down there, I think.
True.
So we saw those.
Plus, did you tend to really just stay down here? I mean, you really didn't want to go?
There was plenty to do for some reason. We were on the beach. You had beach parties at least once a week. You'd go to the channel and walk out on that old wooden pier. The daring kids would swim across the channel and back. That we didn't tell our parents, but they knew. And we took canoes up the old channel, had picnics. I don't know, there seemed to be something going all the time. There weren't telephones, and if you hung around the dock and you needed some change, why, people received telegrams, which came into the dock, and you'd get to take the telegram up, and you usually got a tip. Well, we knew who gave the best tip, of course, so we were very careful to try and fade into the background when they had a telegram for somebody we knew would say, just slip it under the door, Sonny. That was a bad sign. There's nothing coming from that one.
So that's how you earn your money,
man. A little extra that way. But a big tip was a dime.
Yeah.
Now, nickel, we sort of thought they owed us, but we didn't always get it.
Yeah.
I heard speaking of tipping, this morning I was talking to Rex Funnell, who was one of the caddies at the golf club, and he told me there were as many as 50 of them, young kids there in the early days, and he would get Horace Clark now and then. Now, the Clarks have been gone a long time. I think that the house that Polly Dupree has was the Clark's house, but I'm not positive about that. Anyway, Horace was a very soft-spoken, quite religious man, and Rex Funnell carried his bags a number of times and remembers very well, I think whatever the price was for 18 holes, why, that's what Horace gave him, and then he'd say, "And young man, your reward will come in heaven." So they didn't rush to caddy for Horace.
Well, I wouldn't be one of your nickel tippers there, you know? So many times, actually, you would just hang around the dock down there, just waiting for the telegrams to come.
Sure. Well, we were there, and I can't remember whether it was. I think Mrs. Spickelmeyer. It would be Charlie's wife, Chester's mother, was the postmistress, and I think she handled that. And she'd just call out a telegram. She'd never say where it was going, because if it was going to Mrs. Stewart, who was the farthest house there, you wouldn't rush to get it. You wanted to get the nearby ones. And she wouldn't give the name. She would just say telegram, and you took your chances. And hope
you take turns, you guys? Just
no, just whoever felt like it.
Felt like,
yeah.
And then you wait for the guy to come back with the funds, for the day. Oh, that's fair. That's neat. That's neat. You mentioned the name Footcraft, and in the Sylvan Beach history book, there is an incident, and there seemed to be conflict. There was a problem with the Footcraft, but yet it sounded like, from what you're saying, that they blended right in after.
I think the only possible problems would be because they weren't part of the association. And Mr. Footcraft Sr. Was a fairly hard man, I guess you would say, in business. But I don't remember anything specific about him. And the boys, Chester, who played golf with the men about my father's age, maybe, and maybe two others, and then there's a daughter. And Chester had two daughters who were part of our group. They lived down at that little cottage just before you turn into the lighthouse.
Okay, yes, okay.
And they were very attractive girls. But they and the Flitcraft gang played in the baseball on Sunday. I imagine it was just because they weren't part of the association. Some people didn't take to that. I don't know.
It was a type of elitism in a way.
Yeah.
What in your lifetime, which has been great, what are some of the notable characters that you can remember that have been
up here?
Yeah.
Well, I've mentioned some already. Of course, the Spickelmeyers were a marvelous family. They built the most of the cottages, or ones that were here originally.
I've often heard that Spickelmeyer never measured correctly. Is this true? Just everything was kind of worked in.
That's how it would fit in. Yes, with the way old carpenters. I doubt if any of them did it differently. Today they're more precise because lumber comes in standard sizes, which it didn't particularly then. And Charlie, the grandfather. His eye was so good, I would guarantee you couldn't measure with a rule better than he could point out instantly by eye.
Yeah.
He also built chimneys. He was brilliant at that.
Fancy hands.
Yeah.
Wow. That's a lot.
And they did everything by hand.
Yeah.
You know, there were no power tools.
Yeah. And I mean, if it worked and it kept the rain out, who cares about measuring right? But nowadays we're more technical because we have more tools to do it better.
Yeah.
So that, yeah, I've often heard that. So he was a real character, right? You figured
he was a wonderful guy. He lived a long time. He's got, as old people do, a little shorter every year. And bent his wife, who was the postmistress, was stone deaf. So that anybody she spoke to, it was a shout. She spoke so she could hear it maybe, but I doubt if she could. And the Postal Service was informal in those days. I remember my mother coming back one day that she brought the mail up and had a postcard, and apparently she'd gone to get it, and Mrs. Spickelmeyer said, Bertha, you have a card from so-and-so. She says they're all going to such-and-such this week. So it was not exactly your own private mail.
Yeah, it was pretty public then,
yeah.
Everything you did. And some of the other characters that's famous in the notable, and just the characters you're telling me about.
Well, I'm just trying to sort of go up and down the beach to remember who was here. The Pillinger families, of course, were always very colorful, and I think Harry today is just the way they all were. They're warm and flamboyant and always doing things that seemed a little odd. They were great sailors, or at least Harry was, and one of the best sailors ever around. He lived down there next to where the Wob Club was. Then there were other Pillingers. Ed Pillinger was up on the White Lake side of Sylvan. And Harry's father, his name was Harold, and his mother was Mabel, and they were very well known around. Next door to them were the Weismans. Lois, who was one of the pretty girls, everybody, but she was just a little older than I think maybe Bud Runyon would go out with Lois. Then the Rosses were there with their daughter Betsy, who was one of our Jinx stars always, went on in the theater. And
big time, right?
Yeah. Yes, I heard many years later when National Touring Company of Oklahoma got to Cincinnati, Bob and Gene Schmidt got hold of Betsy, who was in the ballet line, and said, bring everybody to our house. And that party lasted longer than anyone could remember that it was carrying on.
A good time was had by
Yeah. Of course, I just mentioned Bob Schmidt. There was one of our great all-time characters. And
what did he used to do? I remember just vaguely.
Just a silly example. We played golf regularly, and in those days, I'd come up on Friday night, and my room was at the back of the cottage above the road, and there'd be a honk in the morning. I'd been up late, and I'd look out the window, and there was Schmidt. He'd say, come on, we're going to play golf. I said, Robert, go back to bed. It's ladies' day. He said, you get down here right away. So down the hill I went, and he had some grass skirts and great wigs made out of straw, and he said, there's no reason they should have that day without us. So we had to go over and got into this gear, and the ladies took it very well and put us up first on the tee. We had a fine time, but that's the kind
typical
of thing.
Bob Schmidt.
And you knew his son Doug very well, and that's where it came from.
Okay, I wonder. Well, but then his mother's a character too. Jeannie's a character.
Oh yes, and just the whole gang were marvelous.
That's fantastic. Do you remember during this period, like for instance, nowadays we have a lot of parties. Was it a formalized party type of situation? Did people tend to get all the cocktail parties?
Now there wasn't that much of it, I don't think. It seems to me that my mother had people in to dinner fairly regularly, but there weren't as many very big parties that I recall. There were things that were standard that happened every year, like the Pirates Ball at the Yacht Club, and they may have had one of those potlucks at the Wob Club, but I just don't remember when that started.
Okay.
There's a lot more of it.
Formalized social function. Do you think that's good or bad?
I think it's very good.
Okay.
In those days, it might not have made a difference, but today, you have people that are here for a short period of time, a month or maybe 2 weeks even. You have people who are renters and have heard about it and maybe know one other person. This gives them a chance to meet everybody all at once, and it's so much more fun. And for the most part, they've been very delightful people, and everybody else is glad that they have a chance to meet them. It's not as ingrown as it used to be.
Yeah, that's a very good point. Just something just found in my mind. Do you remember when you were younger, what type of beer you drank? What was the brand?
I don't think we had any choice. My young days, there was Schlitz and Budweiser and Pabst and Blatz. I think that was all. The Detroit beer wasn't shipped over here. Stroh's at that time, although I imagine they were in business. That's about what we had. And there was only one of each. You didn't have eight kinds of Budweiser, for instance. There was Budweiser, period.
Did you buy it in six packs?
I don't think they sold six packs. It was all in bottles. And you could buy a bottle or a case, I suppose.
Okay. Where'd you buy it?
Oh, golly. Well, the grocery store. They didn't, I think Michigan, I've forgotten when it became a state liquor thing, but usually the gas stations, and of course that's, they stopped. But in those days, that was something you could get at a gas station.
I'll be nice, so you just went to a gas station and bought your beer. And what was the age then?
18 at the beginning.
Okay.
And I believe that somewhere in there they moved it to 21 and then back again.
Okay. Was it 3-2 or?
Well, that was before, you know, the first year before we had beer, you had the so-called near beer.
Okay, 3-2, low. Okay.
You'd get,
just as fat as
yeah,
that,
well, that wasn't exactly beer, I discovered. I mean, you'd get sick before you'd get drunk, I'll tell you that.
Bloated and everything. Oh, God. Oh, yeah, that must have been something. I guess they had that for a year before, then they could manufacture real beer again.
Yeah.
A lag time or whatever it took to get it up. Back to notable characters. Did you ever have probably the most famous name, or not famous, but the one you hear the greatest amount is Joe Sedoni. Do you have any stories?
Well, I of course knew Joe and Art through sailing, and my parents were very good friends of Joe Sr. and his wife. And they used to go over to Valley of the Pines once a summer for dinner. And they maintained quite a close relationship. I knew the boys only when I was older and we all sailed. And of course they were sailing their A-boat, the Nemesis. And I had an E-boat at that time.
Oh, you had an E-boat at that time?
Yeah. And so I got to see them a lot because I was at the yacht club a lot and that then. I still see Art Sedoni 5 times a week, I think, and I've gone back over old days with him, especially the time when I was away and he was in the Army and some of the things that went on. And I've heard some of the stories from Jack DeFraga way back about things that had gone on. The only, rather close family story, Mr. Sedoni, of course, was known to they called him a seer or something. The fact is that he was very, very well read and had an analytical mind, and that helped him make some kind of a prognostication. The earliest story was a child that was drowned in White Lake and they hadn't found the body, and they'd searched and searched and nobody could do it, and Mr. Sedoni called the Coast Guard people and said, if I were you, I'd look in such and such a place. And indeed, the body was found. And they said, oh, this is remarkable what he can do. Well, what he could do is he had been interested in the lake. He had studied the flow of water. He knew what the wind had been the day this happened. And he was a very, very bright man. And a body floating is going to go in a certain pattern if you know where the water is going, and he did. Nobody else thought of things like that, but he was the kind that did do it.
Okay, so he just took deductive reasoning and used it at a time when...
Sure, and a lot of knowledge. People aren't interested in that kind of thing. Today you hear more about it, but somebody who was interested in lake water was some kind of a special nut, I suppose, but he was interested in that, but everything else. Now, the one thing, point I was going to get, because he had this reputation, when I was in college, some kid went nuts and had a gun, and he shot a couple people, including me. It came out on the radio, and of course, my parents heard it, they hadn't heard from me yet, and my mother was quite frantic, and the first call she had was from Mr. Sedoni. He said he had just heard that and he wanted to reassure her that her son would never die from gunshot. And the way he said it completely relaxed her. She calmed down and everything was fine. And my call came in an hour later. I was just shot through the shoulder. I was fine. But she believed anything he said from that day on,
yeah,
I'll tell you.
We were suddenly alive.
Yeah.
Why'd you get shot? What, the guy just went crazy.
He just went crazy, yeah.
What type of gun? What caliber?
Johnson Smith 22. Yeah. You could buy them in a catalog. He bought two.
And they shot you in the shoulder, thank God.
Yeah, he shot this other fella and killed him and then killed himself. But it was a one-day thing. We got in the Hearst Sunday supplement. That was about it.
Well, I'm glad you're here.
Yeah.
I never heard that song.
Well, when the World War II started, I happened to have been in Pearl Harbor at the time, and my mother was as calm as can be because Joe Sedoni had told her son wouldn't be ever die from gunfire. And she assumed it extended beyond that first little incident, so she was just fine.
A good example of faith.
Yeah.
Wow. That is a wild story. And I have this on my list. You were at Pearl when Pearl was bombed. Can you tell us what rank you were and how long you'd been in the service and
well,
how you happened to be there?
That was December 41. I went in 1st of October in 40.
Were you drafted?
The draft was coming up. I was avoiding the draft.
Yeah.
I didn't quite have Slick Willie's way of handling that, but the basic idea was I'd rather have a commission than not. Now this was my chance to get it. And when we got through and got our commissions, we were on the old battleship Arkansas. They gave us a choice of inactive duty or picking some kind of sea duty. And I picked inactive. I didn't want to stay in the Navy. I just wanted the commission. That lasted about 3 weeks, I think. And they called and said, okay, you've had your inactive and now report to Honolulu. So that's how I happened to be there.
Wow. What were you doing when Pearl was bombed that morning?
I was on our ship, which was the destroyer. I was an ensign. And I was off to the deck at the time, so I was watching the planes come over. They came they're very close and very slow in those days. You could see everything. I thought it was an army maneuver. I didn't know why they had the big red balls painted on the planes, but I thought it was realistic.
Yeah.
But it wasn't that kind of a surprise. I have a letter somewhere that I had written home. The Saturday, that was on a Sunday, on the previous Saturday, the day before, to the effect that the Army had put sandbags around all the bridges and they were on close maneuvers and we were sure something was going to happen. But no one thought of airplanes. It was going to be a landing.
Yeah.
That was the idea at the time, I guess.
Or sabotage or whatever.
Well, of course, there were, place was full of Japanese that lived there. And everyone had a story about it was sure my guy was involved in something. They claimed that the Japanese laundry had a big arrow pointing towards Pearl Harbor on the roof. But those were not true stories. They just things that came up afterward. I think they were probably as loyal as anybody else.
Yeah, probably. They're just unfortunate for that. You had to be there. When did you first figure out that it was for real?
Well, we could see that these were not dummy drops. Everything was blowing up. The Arizona, I guess, was the nearest battleship to us, and it was badly hit. The only people we lost, I sent a boat crew over because there was burning oil all around the Arizona, and there were people in it to pick out anybody they could get. And we lost one man in that boat crew. That was our only casualty.
Wow! Thank God for that. Boy, that must have been a real shock that day to you. Do you have any impressions, anything that you?
Oh, well, I've told the story too many times for everybody, but we finally did. We didn't even have any boilers lighted off, but we finally got our engines going, and the signals that indicated we were to get out of the harbor, which made sense. So we got going, and we were tied up at the time alongside the old USS Baltimore, which had been part of Teddy Roosevelt's Great White Fleet. It was on the bottom there, in prior to getting away, why I had gotten the guns manned, and we had two 50 caliber machine guns. And again, in those days, there were no stops on them. They were on a swivel thing, and you could move them anywhere you wanted. Nowadays, there's a ring there to keep you from shooting your own people. But we didn't have that. And the guy that was running them was following a plane down, shooting, and shot the whistle off of the Baltimore. That was our greatest target. But subsequently, we did get underway, and as we're coming to the channel, big flag hoist goes up on that Marine station, and I said to the quartermaster, "What's the flag hoist say?" He said, "I haven't any idea." Well, I said, "Don't we have a book that tells that?" "Oh, yes." So he got the book out and looked it up, and it said, "This channel is mined." I said, "All right, get me the chart for the mine." He said, "Oh, we don't have any chart." Our captain, by the way, was not aboard at that time. We subsequently picked him up out in the ocean. He and a bunch of other guys came out. They had been in town where they lived. Most of the officers lived in town with their families. Only the bachelors had to stay on board. So we're starting the channel. There's a ship ahead of us that was zigzagging. I said, "Well, they've got a chart. So what we do is get close as we can and then zig when they zig and zag when they zag." That was going along just fine till the fellow ahead of us signals back, "What are you doing?" "Why," we said, "we're following you through the minefield." "Minefield hell," he says, "our rudder was shot off."
Oh, jeez.
That's the one I remember.
That's great. That's great. How did you lose the man on board the boat that you sent?
The oil caught the thing on fire, and they somebody managed to back it away, but not before. It was so hot. When you look at it, you can't believe the heat. It was melting the metal, so I know it was hot.
Must have just a plain inferno.
Yeah.
God. Did you escort any of the carriers out? Did you meet any of the carriers?
There weren't any carriers. That was our salvation.
They were out. That's right.
The first carrier back was the Enterprise 2 or 3 days later, and we almost finished them off. We had no radar. And we are on inshore patrol, so we're looking for submarines. We did have a beginning type sonar gear. And we're going back and forth, and it's blackout. Now, a year later, blackout wouldn't have bothered anybody, but we had never had blackout before. So we're cruising along, and suddenly it looks like there's a building alongside or right in front of us that was the Enterprise coming in. And fortunately, we went into full reverse and didn't cause any damage.
Yeah.
So that was the first carrier back.
Yeah, because we only have three left, right?
Enterprise, Saratoga, and maybe something else.
Yeah, Hornet.
Then they build a lot of smaller ones later on.
Oh, that's wild. That's wild. Where did you go after that in the Navy?
We stayed in the Pacific. I was transferred to a larger destroyer and then went across with the Pacific Fleet. We went to... I've forgotten what the first place was where the Marines went in the Gilbert. Oh no, the Gilbert Islands. We went across the Central Pacific. Tarawa and something else. And then we went on farther to Eniwetok and eventually ended up doing the Saipan Guam invasion.
Wow.
And then we were hit out there and they sent us back to the Navy Yard.
How'd you get hit?
We were an 8-inch shore battery. We were in close supporting troops. We had a young man who either was crazy, subsequently I thought he was crazy. He went ashore and we had these grids and he'd go along and tell us where he was and then where the enemy guns were. That's what we were looking for. And we would try and keep ahead of his square, and nothing seemed to bother him very much. And so we were shooting without any trajectory. This is point blank stuff. I mean, we would shoot at a tank with a battery of 5-inch guns, or 5-inch we had, and that would dissolve a tank.
Oh my God,
but one of these big 8-inch guns they had, which is a big gun, and they were firing anti-personnel shells. So when that hit our little thin skinned ship, Why, I'd go inside and then just blast out. And they hit three or four quick hits. We had a marvelous captain. He didn't bat an eye. He said, "Who sees that gun?" And had every, he never even moved. We stayed right there and swung around and got the gun. He got the Navy Cross that day.
Good for him.
Yeah.
Good for him. That's wild. And then you had to go
get
back
out. We got back to Pearl Harbor, but there was no room there. And we went to San Diego, and they had us fixed enough. So we had one engine going in Pearl, and we got to San Diego. That was full. We went all the way around to Charleston, which was delightful.
Nice to get away.
Spent the rest of the war in the Atlantic and Mediterranean. We had that nice milk run. We went over to Iran and escorting ships across, and they were slow. It was a long trip.
Was this in the North Atlantic?
No, we were in the South. In the South Atlantic.
Yeah, the North would be the
Mermaid. We went up from Norfolk into Iran, and then we came back to New York. I think that was the way it went, and then started over again.
What was the name of your ship?
Phelps. DD-360.
Okay, and then for the rest of the war, you were in the Atlantic Theater, basically. Did you see more action in the Atlantic Theater?
No, there wasn't any. We never saw anybody except some airplanes. I think the most dangerous thing we ever had was the plague at Mers El Kébir, and then we had to keep the men on board. They had that kind of stuff all the time, and we never could understand how, we found out later, how the men got so drunk after nobody had been ashore. Well, when we were fueling out in the harbor, some smart bosun's mate put a hose, a little garden hose across, and they pumped red wine on board for these guys. They're ingenious, I'll tell you.
Yeah. Scoundrels.
When the captain wanted to get underway, nobody could stand up.
Oh. It was. What did your captain say?
Well, he understood.
Good.
Yeah.
Well, that was neat of him. Done.
Yeah.
That's the thing. So the rest of the war, thank God for you, was basically fairly quiet. And,
yeah. Uh-uh. Right at the very end, that German submarine was going to give itself up. And we were one of the ships in the area. They knew about where it was. And so we had to go through the little bit of 24-hour training as to what you do if one of these things comes up and you're supposed to take it over. Very fortunately, it didn't come up where we were, because I thought it was sort of scary. The first thing you do is go aboard and you take a big hunk of anchor chain and weld it onto the hatch on the conning tower and then to the deck, so that after you were aboard they couldn't close up the thing and submerge. I wouldn't have thought of that. Then
no,
we had to, I really wasn't the one that should have gone on, but I was scheduled for it because I had about 8 words of German from my 6th grade study of Emil und die Detectives. And so they thought I could read the gauges and see that everything was all right. Well, that we lucked out.
Yeah. That doesn't sound like that would be very relaxing at all. That's fascinating. Got us kind of off, but I love it. I mean, it's very important.
Yeah, that's hardly White Lake, isn't it?
No, but it's you and you're part of White Lake, and that's very important to me, because I think that's real history, too. The more notable characters, again, back, do you remember famous people that would come to White Lake in very many times?
Well, of course, the Sidonies had more famous people than anybody. Wayne King was a fairly regular visitor.
Okay, who was Wayne King?
Oh, my goodness, Wayne King, the Waltz King, one of the great bands of the 30s and on from there. Art Sidoni still has one of his saxophones, which he plays. Wayne was a saxophonist. And then they had some movie people, but I don't recall them particularly, which ones were there.
Do you think, off the subject for a second, somebody told me that Art Sidoni probably wouldn't want to do this. Do you think he'd want to do this?
I don't know. He loves to talk about things like that.
Yeah, well, I'll ask you. Somebody said don't ask him. Because he's been sick or something?
Well, he's got bad knees, and just recently they have found some heart problem, which he's not going to have anything done with. So, but he plays golf.
Okay, so he's still okay. Great. So, Mr. Sodoni was probably very just observed a lot of things, made sense.
He studied everything, and as I say, he was a very brilliant man.
And so what some would mistake as psychic powers would just be good old using your knowledge.
That's exactly right. And I think I've never discussed it very seriously with Art, but I have the impression that he understood exactly
what he
thought that he probably had a little something. I think some people have a feel, but whether it's extrasensory or whether it's the fact that you have studied, I don't know.
Yeah. I don't mean this as a bad question about the man. Do you think did he enjoy? Did he kind of use this notoriety?
Never did.
Okay.
I would say, in fact, just the opposite.
Played it down.
He played it down. There were people who were great fans of his that would drum up some stories, but I never heard of anything coming out of the Valley of the Pines at all.
Okay.
No, he. He just loved people, and he loved the science of the world, and he wanted to know as much as he could about everything. I haven't been there for so long, I don't recall the library, but I'm sure they had an awful lot of books.
Yeah, and I assume it was time he wrote a book also, The Gates of the Mind.
Yeah.
I think, did you ever read that? Or?
I'm sure I have. I know there used to be a copy in our cottage.
Okay. Do you remember... famous people coming to the golf club, too? Or?
Well, most recent was a couple years ago, Bob Hope. But,
oh, wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah, and he was here to appear at Blue Lake, I think.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And called and got hold of Lance Avery, who was the manager in the pro, and asked if any chance he could play. And Lance said, well, certainly he could play. Did he have a time? And he said, yes. And then he said to Lance, perhaps you'd like to play with me. And Lance, of course, was just thrilled. Well, unfortunately, the only day he had for it, it poured down rain and there was no golf, which is really too bad because Lance was so excited he could hardly walk.
To see Bob Hope, yeah, that'd be incredible. Do you remember anybody else coming?
Well, I'm sure there are, and it's just hard to pull one out. I'm trying to think of the various cottages and. There were a number of people that were. Oh, I'm talking too much.
No, do you want something wet and refreshing?
Oh, no, thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I'm fine too. Thank
okay,
you very
sure.
much, so thank
okay.
you. So, not too many, except for Mr. Sodoni, of course.
We had.
Star.
Yeah, during the war, Elliot Roosevelt, of course, was here.
Ruth Edson.
Yeah.
Okay, and now did the president ever come here? Did FDR ever come here?
I don't believe so.
Did we ever have a president come to Sylvan Beach, do you think?
No, I'm trying to remember no, I'm sure not.
Okay.
The closest thing you'd have is Art Godwin's stepdaughter, I think.
Is it Betty Ford?
Yeah.
Okay, that's right. I'd heard, thank you. Thank you. Do you remember the Sylvan Beach Hotel?
Sure.
Tell me about it.
All I can tell you, the first thing is that in spite of what a lot of people still believe, it didn't burn down. They tore it down.
I'll be darned.
Yeah.
So that's just a piece of fantasy. Okay. What, was it a very big hotel or?
It was big in the sense of, the cottages around here, but it wasn't, it was about it was bigger than a double cottage, but just a big clapboard building.
And as how many rooms do you think?
Oh, golly. I'd have to say there couldn't have been more than 20 or 30 maybe at the outside.
Okay. Was it generally booked up during the summer fairly well?
I don't remember anybody having any trouble getting in, except that there were plenty of people who came up here so often we thought of them as Sylvan Beachers, who always stayed there and booked a year ahead.
Okay. Now, did that, what year did they tear that down?
I don't know.
Okay. During this period of time, you said you didn't have phones. Did the hotel have a phone?
Well, it had the first one when they finally got them.
Okay, it had the first phone.
Yeah.
Okay. Was that used by people very much? Was it?
Well, in the beginning, people didn't think about phones anyway, but gradually, yes, the businessmen would have reason to use it, and other people, I'm sure, checking on guests, but we didn't think of phones very much.
What are your memories about the hotel? Are there any in particular?
No, I've read some things that were before my time. I think, and you can find this out because I've read it in recent years again, that the chap who ran it in the very beginning had been the head steward on one of the Goodrich boats. He was a colored gentleman and very highly thought of. And I can't tell you where I've read that, but it's been in the last couple of years.
He ran the hotel?
Yeah.
Well, the story about the colored chauffeur hit me too fast.
Sydney, his name was. I've got that now.
Sydney
was the Renshaw's chauffeur.
Was he ever a guest in somebody's house? Had we reached that point yet?
No. There were a number of colored staff around here, and Mrs. Chittenden's Nancy was famous all over the area. And they had a hierarchy that was rigid, I'll tell you, and Nancy determined it. And you fit into their social scheme the way she saw you. And of course, Sidney was a favorite because he also was a good fisherman, and Nancy was a marvelous fisherwoman. So they had their picnics and that sort of stuff.
Did they basically picnic down at Sylvan Beach?
Usually this side of the channel.
Near Murray's on this side.
Where they'd been fishing, yeah.
Okay. That's fascinating. You mentioned the colored chauffeur that played ball with you fellows. Was that ever an issue, a racial issue?
No. Everybody loved Sidney.
Yeah.
And he had the added advantage of being able to hit the ball a ton. So you scrambled to get him on your team.
Yeah, so he had a lot to give him, so you didn't mind. That's fascinating. Question, what was the worst storm you can remember here at Sylvan Beach?
Well, that was in the one I remember, not necessarily as measurably the worst, was during the Mackinac race. And I can't tell you what year, but I think it was before color film, if that gets it down. My father has a picture of one of the boats that was in a bad way offshore here, but finally got into White Lake. Part of the Mackinac thing. And we had a lot of them in here in other years with storms, but that's the worst one I remember. And they lost several boats that year.
Was there loss of life?
Well, I don't think so.
So the color film, so that would probably be about 37, 36.
Yeah, something in there.
And color came about 39,
yeah.
Didn't it,
that photo he took is over in the other cottage someplace. It isn't much to see. It just you can tell it's a storm. And
were you here at the time?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
What do you remember about it?
Storms were nothing. I loved storms. When I was young, I slept on the porch, the front porch, and all the storms came. And we didn't have regular sheets. We used cotton sheets in those days, which kept you plenty warm. And when you're outside like that, so the storm had come through and you just pull a blankets over your head, and your mother in the morning would say, "Why didn't you come in during the rain?" Well, you couldn't feel the rain. You were under the covers. That was
having fun.
Yeah.
So that was the worst storm.
The worst. And there was an issue of the Yacht Club News that covered that pretty well with some good pictures.
Thank you. I had no idea. Great. Thank you. Because in the end, that was great. What was the junior yacht club like when you were younger? Was that a new economy?
Well, it went through changes the way the senior yacht club did. If you recall, some years way back, I guess, they were in financial problems, which they kept getting into. When I was involved in it, I think I was secretary. The juniors were a pretty good, cohesive bunch. the senior yacht club was falling apart. And we had a regular event for everybody once a week. We'd have a moonlight race, we had treasure hunts, all kinds of things, group sort of stuff. They each one kicked in a nickel, and we'd have a small prize out of if we had enough nickels, but we always had enough so at the end of our year we could give something to the yacht club, and that's where I think that started. Our first gifts were quite modest, but we gradually built up, and I think that built up the enthusiasm for the club, and as those youngsters got older, why, they got more involved in the regular yacht club, and they finally straightened things out over there. Those are difficult years for people who are having, the depression years. Your own family and your own company was a problem, and you didn't have much time to worry about what was happening with the yacht club. But somebody had to do it, and they did.
Yes, you brought me a fascinating point. What do you remember about the depression years here at Sylvan? And as a young person,
at that age, I didn't think of things as seriously, I suppose, but as far as Sylvan was concerned, there were just a lot of things that couldn't be done. They had rules which had to be overlooked. For instance, you couldn't rent your cottage for more than such a period of time, and the same person couldn't have it every year, and all sorts of things that made sense when they were put in, but it wouldn't work under these circumstances. People had to get some money, and there were those who I'm sure couldn't pay their dues for a year or two, and the rules were they forfeit and so forth. Well, that was never invoked, and it wouldn't or shouldn't have been. It's a family organization. You operate as a family, and it was done just. I think there were. Did some things that were careless, but never without charity. So it worked. It worked fine.
Well, there's no script for depression or life. You have to work with. Yeah. During the depression, were there very many people up here that were wiped out by it?
Yeah, I'm sure.
You don't have to give names.
Well, but there were, the ones I can think of specifically were strong people who started something else and did fine.
Have you seen any worse periods since then in America?
No.
No, it was that bad. It was one out of
Well, there was no safety net.
Yeah.
Nowadays, nobody even thinks about it.
Yeah, different things. But do you remember in 29? Do you remember the day of the crash? Or?
No.
Your dad come home and go, whoa.
No, I do remember that it wouldn't have made any difference to him at all. He had no investments. He had a growing family, and he never had anything except life insurance. He was over-insured, but he just didn't have any extra cash to invest in anything.
What was the biggest wedding that you can remember?
Up here?
Yeah, Silver Beach.
Golly. I just, I can't tell you. I've been, the one I recall most particularly because it was sort of in my own family, one of the Dacey girls was being married. I guess it was Bennett Dacey Kramer, in the Wob Club, and they were having the reception up at my mother's cottage afterward. Bill Hodson did the service, and it was a driving rainstorm. And we had some of the youngsters, my young son Tommy and Tommy Dacey, and those kids were supposed to be helping out with seating and so forth. Well, when Bill Hodson finished, there wasn't an obvious end to it, and the bride and groom went down the aisle, and the people were still sitting there, and my young son Tom came out and stood in front and said, "You can all go now." This is a little stunning, but
That's great. And that's because I remember Tommy Hearts and Tommy Dacey used to hang around together all the time.
Oh yeah.
That was a big duo. That's right. I had forgotten that. That is funny. Any other big weddings you can think of?
No, there have been some, and I'm sure we've attended them, but I haven't.
Just nothing that.
No.
Outstanding at the moment. You mentioned Jack DeFrago, which is not Sylvan Beach, of course, but there's a story that I've heard continually through the years. Was he the fellow that used to go out and play the trumpet in White Lake?
No, that was Lois Weisman's husband.
Okay.
And he came back a few years ago, still could do it. Had a good lip, it was clear as a bell.
Now, how long did that go on, and do you remember the period?
I remember the period. He played a lot of the songs we all liked, and he was a professional musician, I think eventually in Florida, but I don't know. And they came back here some years afterward, and it was just like old times, almost teary-eyed, suddenly at sunset to hear this clear trumpet out over the lake. And they took one of those float boats out into Lake Michigan so that the ones along the shore could hear it too.
Oh,
it was fun.
Wonderful. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he'd do that generally about dusk or something. He would
out. Well, when they lived in the cottage there, he'd just sit on his porch and do it. It was after they had been away and came back with it, they'd get a boat and go out in the lake.
Was that the Reitz cottage? Or?
That was his name.
Okay.
Johnny Reitz.
Okay, then that would have been Arnold. That was our cottage. The original, I mean, not Reitz, but now. Okay.
Yeah, but it was the Weismans originally, I think. Now. That was her family.
Okay. Yeah, there's a connection there to the families, and did you take sailing school up here at White Lake?
Of course. I have my, downstairs in my workshop, my diploma is still there, class of 29. That was we consider the most famous class. John Getz and Franny Hanchett. I've forgotten, but we had that thing at the Yacht Club a few years ago when they asked all this gang to come back, and we had quite a few of our group still there.
I remember your age group was better than our. My age group was represented.
Yeah, that was a great bunch.
Oh, that was
fun. Later years, my mother went to sailing school along with Carolyn Getz and some of the other ladies. They all had claimed they sailed as young girls, and this was just a brush up.
Just a brush up a little, yeah. How many years of sailing school did you take back then?
I think two.
Do you remember your teachers at all?
Well, Bill Getz was our instructor, and Jack Guerin and Locher Chittenden were the heads of the school. They all signed the diploma.
I think that's really, unless, do you have any?
I'm just memories? Trying to go back along the beach because there. I'm sure there are some names, of course. The Naveens were always very well known. They started the church, and I think that's how Johnson Meyer first came here. I had a regular job Saturday afternoon to deliver the church notices for Mr. Naveen, for which he paid me a dime. And
what was a church notice?
There was a notice of the next day's church. You'd get it every Saturday. It was printed on glossy paper and had the subject of the sermon and the time, so forth.
Okay.
And he financed all this. This was his own thing. I was really quite small in the beginning. And when I had to get to those cottages that were at the south end of Sylvan Beach, you had to go through some woods and all. And I used to think that was a little terrifying down there. It was dark in the afternoon, late afternoon. But that I did for a number of years. He finally raised me to a dime, so it must have been really a long time.
Now, he started the Naveen Trust Company? Is he the one?
No, it's the Mutual Fund Company.
Okay.
John Naveen and Company.
Okay. And he started the church, and he was the prime mover.
Yeah.
Who did you use for a minister then? Did you have
Johnson Myers?
Oh, Johnson Myers. Okay.
So, who was in the cottage that the that's the eye doctor, John Hunkler.
Oh, the Hunkler.
Hunkler has that cottage.
Okay. Was it what type of service was it? Was it
Well, he was a Unitarian minister, which I can't tell you what that means.
I was going to ask you, what is he?
Now, I think it's generally about what you have with Bill Hodgson and Gil Bowen. They're congregational of sort, but it was an ecumenical service. There was never anything that was specific to their church. In fact, in each of the cases of those three, they were so much a part of the association and everybody here that the services had to do with something that was really locally important, almost always. It would be drawn from that.
Yeah.
They were all very good at parables, and it was done that way, which is why they maintained an enormous attendance.
Yeah. Well, and then the quality of the ministers was good. You know, it's been incredible what we've had since then. Jack DeFraga, back to Jack DeFraga, a character.
He lived over at the Valley of the Pines.
Now, did he work for Mr.
Yes, and eventually built a house over there. His nephew was a fellow named Jim Spencer at Spring Lake, a very famous family in the sailing things there. And that was the only kin he had. Jim Spencer was his sister's son. And when Jack died, he left that house to the Spencers, and they came and moved it. I'm not sure he even owned the property. It may still belong to the Sidonis. I just don't know. But he was a brilliant sailor.
When did he sail?
Well, he sailed with the Joe and Art on Nemesis, but he sailed Ease. He sailed with me for a year or so, and the best light canvas guy that ever lived. And according to Bill Getz, who knows more about it than I do, that he was really one of the Western, or maybe all of inland racing's best sailors. Wow. And he could take anybody's boat and do better than whoever had it. He originally sailed with Ed Middleton on Hope, which was the first E on the lake, I think. But he was a fascinating man. He knew antiques. He made his living getting ideas of what people wanted, and then going up, driving up and down through Michigan to these farms and all, and buying things and then reselling them.
Wow.
He told me a story I will swear is apocryphal, but that his father had been the lighthouse keeper in Grand Haven in a Portuguese family. He said, you know about how Portuguese children are raised, and I said I didn't, and there'd been a lot of kids making a lot of noise, and he was saying, well, you do with the child in Portugal is you put it in one of those big wine casks and you feed it through the bunghole until its 16th birthday. And I said, then what? He said, then you seal a cask. Straight face, of course. But that's the story I'd heard of him, and again, I don't know that at all. But that everybody said he was the son of the lighthouse keeper in Grand Haven. He started a Sea Scout troop here, which lasted one summer maybe. Its principal purpose, the Coast Guard station was being closed, and their motor whale boat was to be disposed of. And it was indicated that it would be a good thing for a Sea Scout troop. So he formed a Sea Scout troop and got the motor whale boat. So he had that for all the rest of his time. It was marvelous. And the Sea Scouts went out on it that first year, but we sort of disbanded. We wouldn't do any of the things that you're supposed to do, you know, do
the
all
the discipline part of it.
Yeah.
You didn't want anything to do with it.
No. But it was fine, and he did a good job of it.
Boy, that must have been some boat, too. I mean,
That regular motor whale boat. You see them in the pictures still.
Yeah. But boy, I mean, they were so stable for them, you know, and just functional out there. That's great. Now, Jack DeFraga also did a lot of artwork, didn't he?
He did the maps you'll see everywhere.
That's right.
Yeah.
How did that start? Do you know where it was?
Well, he was a talented artist, and I think the first one he did was for Ed Middleton. He made the drawing of White Lake and put in familiar landmarks so everybody had a feel that it was sort of personal. And then in one section, if you had a boat, and he did this for you, why, there would be your boat with its name under it. and then a little place where this map created four. He did the map, and then he printed a lot of them, and then he filled in for individuals their own personal stuff. So everyone is different in that respect, although the basic map's the same. He subsequently did one of the state of Michigan and more of Lake Michigan, the same kind of thing.
Was he paid for this by the people? Or?
You could ask him to do it, and then you would pay him. Some people, he just did it as a present for them, and when they tried to pay him, he wouldn't take it. So it just depends. If there were people he didn't know well, why, then he'd charge him, but not very much.
So basically, he lived up here permanently?
Yes, okay. All year round.
And how did he earn his keep, just working for him?
Oh, he worked hard over there.
Yeah.
Now, they had all kinds of things going on, so...
Yeah, did you ever go into the laboratory I hear about?
I've only been in the house one time, and just in the main living room and the library, and so I really don't know much about it.
Mm-hmm. Certainly added to the fun, though, of the, you know, the imagination of...
Oh, sure. Well, we had some... following what's Dowie, who was over at that side of the lake, you had... he was what we'd call today, I guess, an evangelist, and would be just another guy, but in those days, well, that was pretty wild, and he'd have his flock come and tell him he was going to walk on water or some such thing, all the little gimmicks. He was sort of a fraud, but maybe he wasn't. Maybe he was genuinely a believer.
Convinced himself.
You just don't know. But anyway, it was very well known, and it was an exciting thing going on over there.
Yeah, did you used to sneak up as a kid?
No, I never did.
Yeah, I think I probably would. Yeah. Just to go over and peek at the whole thing. Was that a very big camp with a lot of people in it?
They came on a weekend, usually announced ahead of time. I don't know how many were there permanently. So that they'd have them all along the shoreline.
Okay. Who did you used to date when you were younger up here?
Oh, Lord.
Did you have anybody particularly, like a summer of love?
No, we didn't work that, we'd spread around. Both Jeannie and Fiffy Murdoch, one time or another. There were some other girls that were only here a summer or two at a time. There was a Hallquist girl. Very cute, considered younger. Another girl named Stewart, whose mother was a model. They lived on the dunes there, next to Berkey Jones's, I think. And she was knockout, but she was not very bright. More the kind I could get along with. Although I've changed my whole mode now. I go for the brains.
The smart thing to do. What about the Gerbers? Do you have any memories of the Gerbers?
Well, I remember when they came there, and Dan and the stories about the girls. One of them was supposed to be the picture on the baby food can. And then I remember really more after they had gone, and the McKinleys had it. And I guess they rented it, but quite regularly.
Oh, yeah.
And so I'd spent more time over there at that time.
Okay. Why did the Gerbers leave? Do you have any...
I think that Dan originally thought that this was a good place for the children. And I think he found it was indeed. But when they grew up and had other interests, and suddenly one of them says, well, I really don't want to spend all summer there. I want to go on this group that's going to have a summer education in Europe or some such thing.
Yeah.
That's what...
Used its time.
Yeah.
I have one more. I was going to just forget. Well, I will come back. By the way, if there's anything you think of too at any time and you want to add on or anything like that, call me because I'm going to keep, you're going to have a whole tape. So if there's anything you think of, please let me know. And if you want to add to it and make notes, let me know.
Well, I hadn't thought of the kinds of things that you might want, but I can see the point of them, and I will give some thought to it, particularly people that have been here that maybe just in and out, but were names that everybody would know.
No, we're Just, yeah, exactly, and the unique characters and things, because that's, you know, part of the Sylvan Beach history.
Because
so.
I have to send you to the shower.
Oh, we are committed to do something?
We are committed at 5:15 at the Manon.
Oh.
Well, we're pretty well finished up here, no problem at all, and I thank you very much. And it was.
Hope I can get my money back from Manon. I just paid him off from the golf course.
That's good.
You can record that, too.
We won't mention scores or anything like that. Would you talk to, do you think Bill Getz is the best Getz? Or would you, which ones would you talk to for the Sylvan Beach history?
Bill, of course.
Oh, I imagine she'll be here.
Okay, would you be adverse to, you know, I think, well, I haven't done that yet, and it's a good idea. Maybe you two just sit down, and we talk to you, all three of us.
Well, we could do that, although, as I told her at the time, when I asked her if she'd like to do it, and she said she would, I said, Leslie will come and see you, because I'm not sure exactly the kinds of things. She doesn't wander off. She sticks to where you start her, and you just have to change as you want, but she's clear as a bell, and she does remember things.
Are she and Peg Van together?
Those two together would be perfect.
Do you think those two?
Yeah, they're close friends.
Okay, and when you see me around and Lauren's up, tell me too, would you, so that I'll know that she's up.
If you'll excuse me, bye, Joe.
Very nice to see you.
I'll
undo you here.